Thank you, Dr. Johnson, Dr. Drazen, for the kind invitation. I'm looking forward to sharing with you a little bit about our experience at Stanford with robotic spine surgery systems, what that means, where we are, and sort of what some of the biggest challenges are in this particular space. I do have some disclosures, not a professional endorsement of any of these things, but it's just some of the things that we use in my practice. So here are the topics that I wanted to sort of review with you. What is robotic spine surgery? When can it be useful? What are some of the pitfalls? And what are really some of the advantages when you look to how to integrate some of this technology into your practice? There are a few fundamental tenets that I think all of us would share. And as we adopt new technology into our practice, I think it's extraordinarily important to remember these and to fall back on them to help prevent, you know, some of the things that we saw and some of the things that can happen when you're trying to push the boundaries of what you're capable of doing. So number one, it's the right patient, right? When you're starting out, when you're trying to figure out how to use this technology, make sure you select a patient whose body mass index is appropriate, whose anatomy is appropriate, and that you're only dealing with one or two moving variables at a time so that you can fully understand how your systems are working, whether it's navigation, whether you're new to MIS, or whether it's a robotics system. It's the right procedure. So instead of starting out with a percutaneous T10 to S2 AI bolts, maybe start with a percutaneous TLIF using a robotic system or a navigation system. And then maintain goal orientation. Don't fit the patient into the surgery that you think you could use to help them. Think about how you want to design the surgery, what your goals are. Is it decompression of the neural element? Is it stabilization? And then figure out if there's a technique that you feel safe using and appropriately apply that to the patient. Prioritize safety. So when you're starting out, make sure you build confidence in the imaging system or in the robotic system by checking things with multiple fail-safes. Take additional x-rays if you have to. Take additional O-arm spins if you have to. But make sure you sort of understand what it is the navigation tools or the robotic systems are helping you do. And so with those kind of things in mind, we try and move forward with integrating new technology. So if we think about current robotic capabilities, there's a preoperative planning tool. It can be called a pedicle cannulation tool. It's instrumentation agnostic. So in many cases, it's the placement of K-wires. What you put down the K-wire is up to you. Radiation reduction. So one X-ray at the beginning or two to help understand and explain to the robot where its robotic arm is with respect to the patient's anatomy, and then moving forward based on a preoperative CT scan. Improvement in accuracy. Do we get the same results with robotics that we see with intraoperative navigation and intraoperative imaging? How about efficiency? If a robotic system is lower profile, doesn't require a new image acquisition technique, can you improve efficiency and reduce the amount of time patients are under anesthesia and in the prone position on the operating room table? And then can it enable you to do something that you haven't done before? If you're not comfortable with AP and lateral fluoro for percutaneous screws, can a robot help you do MIS? Can it help you do some of the more complicated open surgeries or maybe even a hybrid construct? So there's the enabling portion of robotics and navigation that I think is really special as well. So when you think about the workflow, here it is in sort of a big picture. Number one, preoperative planning. When you're thinking about using a robotic system, you have to think a lot about what you're going to do in the operating room to the finest detail before you get there. So you need CT scans. You need to make sure that the robot can reach the various different trajectories. And truthfully, you have to plan. You have to plan out the type of screws you're going to use, the direction, the length and the width, and whether you can actually achieve the angles that you're looking to achieve with the rigid robotic arm that's helping you get to a specific location. You have to mount the robot to the patient. You have to acquire the images. So in certain cases, that's an AP or an oblique image plus another lateral image. And then once you get those images, you have to register it to the robot. So you have to tell the robot where it is and where the patient is with respect to itself. And then robotic assembly, mount the frame, percutaneous fixation, somehow mount the robot to the patient, and then you begin with pedicle cannulation. As we use robotics now, I think the most common application is cannulating the pedicle. So that's what the robot is helping you do. Place a K-wire, or in some particular cases, we're getting closer and closer to closing the loop where we're going to be entering sort of the K-wireless era of some of this technology. So a quick video on what the robot looks like in application. So this is the robotic system that we have and that we use. I don't know if it's going to play. There it goes. Is it working? Yeah. So basically, we have a C-arm. We've taken an AP and lateral X-ray and registered the robot. We have a technician with the robotic system. And you can see the robot moving in the background to the first location, which is probably like an L3 or L4 screw. And you're watching to make sure that there aren't any collisions. You're watching to make sure that it makes sense, that it's reasonably within a place of accuracy. And then you're placing the screw over the K-wire. And you pull the robot out of the way. And you do this just in case a K-wire gets dislodged, or you want to double check your instrument, your accuracy, and so the robotic arm can come right back into place. And so in the end, you get something that kind of looks like this. If you're doing an open case, this was a patient that had an L3 tumor that had to be resected and required stabilization. You can do things that involve a TLIF or, you know, a single level case. And it's surprising because in robotic applications, a single level open TLIF is actually a challenging case for the robot for because of soft tissue pressure. Here's a patient who had a severe spondy at L5-S1. This is sort of a 3D reconstruction of her images. And so we decided to perform what we call a Bowman procedure. You've probably seen that before. So an anterior-posterior approach for this. She had had a previous sacral decompression, an L5-S1 decompression, and they had a lot of difficulty placing the instrumentation. I don't blame them. The anatomic landmarks are very difficult in a patient who's had this type of a spondy for the majority of her life. So this is what preoperative planning looks like. We decided that we would do an L4 to S2AI fusion, and the type of screws that we used were transpedicular at L4 and trans S1 into L5 screws bilaterally from the back, and then S2AI screws. It may be difficult for you to see, but the picture on the right is a X-ray after the anterior procedure was done. There's an L4-5 ALIF just below the trans L5 to S1 screw. You may be able to see a fibular strut graph that we drilled straight through the L5 vertebral body into the sacrum. It may be hard to see here, but just get an idea of what the planning looks like, and then postoperatively, it looks like this. So it's fairly close to what you planned, and right underneath that ALIF graft, right in this region here, is where that fibular strut is. It starts here, and it ends right here, but that was our attempt to stabilize her severe spondy. So this is sort of what you can do and what you can plan, and what you come out with is actually fairly close. So this is well and great, and it allows you to do things that can be fairly technical or straightforward as much as you desire, but there are certainly sources of failure. So here are the most common failures that have been reported in the literature for robotics. Failure of registration, if patient has osteoporosis, complex deformity, anything that results in poor image acquisition. If they have a significantly high BMI over 40, the AP and lateral X-ray, just think about your own patients, the robot can only work as well as what it can see. And so if the X-ray is hard to get, the robot can't, the robot unfortunately isn't a magician like Dr. Johnson earlier. It has a little difficulty with registering itself. So something to keep in mind. Soft tissue pressure. So the arm of the robot is susceptible to soft tissue pressure. You have to make sure that there's nothing pushing on it because it can't tell itself, at least yet in the current generation, that its arm is off by any degree of measure. Different robotic systems have different safety checks and different safety capabilities, but when you're talking about a 1 to 2 millimeter window of error, I think it can be difficult for the robot to pick that up. So sometimes inability to get the acute angles you planned with the software. So if you're trying to get an acute S1 screw, that can be difficult if you're running into the iliac wing. One of the most common failures is drill guide skive. So obviously, we're operating on patients that have either very arthritic facets or degenerative facets that don't provide the appropriate landing spot for a drill guide to sit and remain in place during the tap of the pedicle and so forth. And so the drill guide can skive. It can skive inferior, it can skive medial, and the software knows that and it tries to warn you. But when you're doing these cases MIS, you may not be able to see it. And so there's a lot of feedback that you have to sort of incorporate into your own practice and understanding what the robotic arm is doing and what the drill guide is doing as you're placing it. And then some criticism about whether you should actually plan on a preoperative supine CT whether a prone CT would be better. In my practice, I haven't had a problem with that, but it's certainly something that's been reported in the literature. So when you look at the learning curve, there's always fluctuations motivations and how people learn things. Initially, you have an acquisition of the basic concepts. You feel fairly confident in what you're capable of doing. And then you become humbled very quickly because you start pushing the limits. And then you kind of settle down and you settle out and you find an area where you feel comfortable and where you feel confident that the technology that you're using, no matter what it is, whether it's robotics to, you know, a new type of instrumentation, you're comfortable with how it's working. And then you start to be able to push the boundaries into proficiency. And so this is sort of the learning curve that, you know, I think is widely reported in the literature for other things, but I think it's applicable to robotics in a lot of different ways. So now I thought I'd just share with you a little bit about what the literature suggests regarding the accuracy. So navigation is very different than robotics. Robotics attempts to take, in many cases, a preoperative CT scan, understand how that's changed in the operating room, and guide your hand to a pedicle cannulation landmark that is safe and is also something that you planned before you got to the operating room. So here's a study looking at the clinical acceptance and accuracy of the assessment of spinal implants with the spine assist surgical robot. So this was quite some time ago in 2010. And since then, obviously, all of this technology has accelerated very quickly. Just for the purposes of the studies I present today, many of them use this classification system. And there are various different types, including the Wang classification system. But this is the one that was reported in the literature that I'm going to share with you, and it looks at different levels of deviation from the planned trajectory. And so it's 0, less than 2, less than 4, less than 6, and then greater than 6. And so we're going to go through these studies and sort of see what people thought. So in this particular study, they looked at intraoperative fluoroscopy-based positioning of 3,271 screws that were placed. And what they found was that 98% were clinically acceptable, and they looked at 646 screws inserted over 139 cases, and they reviewed them with a postoperative CT scan. And so this is a critical distinction because some of these cases were reviewed with a postoperative AP and lateral image to see if they were clinically requiring some sort of revision versus ones that were actually available and reviewed with a CT scan afterwards. The other interesting point here is if you look at their time capture of when they place the screws, as they gain experience, as they use the system more and more, obviously the amount of fully executed screws went up and their accuracy went up as well. And so this is just looking at the same group of patients, but sort of over two of the timelines between 2005 and 2009, and then every screw placed after 3 years of experience. Similarly, there was a study about clinical pedicle screw accuracy in robotic guided spine surgery, and they used the robot to place pedicle screws at approximately a 98% accuracy rate, and they thought that in most cases the robot produced a deviation from the planned trajectory by about 2 millimeters plus or minus 1 millimeter. And truthfully, that's what I'm seeing mostly in the literature, that it's around that grade A, grade B, rarely in the grade C category, especially with the literature surrounding intraoperative navigation that is a whole lot more well-established than the more recent robotic applications. When we look at robotic assistance versus freehand pedicle screws, this was a study completed out of China, and they looked at grade A accuracy in the robot group was superior to the freehand group, but when they looked at A plus B, it was about the same. And so I think the question is really going to be, you know, how many instances of a saved revision of a saved clinically symptomatic screw did the robot provide? And I think those trials are just being done in a way that I think would be digestible for us. They did look recently, Dr. Wang's group looked at an initial academic experience with the robot, and they kind of looked at the different amount of time each one of the pedicle screws placed based on the level of resident. I think we heard earlier that you can get sort of intraoperative navigated pedicle screw timing down to about 2 to 3 minutes using per screw using an intraoperative navigation system. Here they quote somewhere between the 3.5 to 4 minute system, 4 minute time frame. And this is with sort of an older generation robot, and as we were just making headwind with how to integrate it into your workflow. So I suspect that those numbers are better. One more trial that I wanted to share with you was this MIS robotic versus open fluoro-guided instrumented fusions. This was a study done out of Korea, and they had randomized the patients into these two groups, so I thought this study would be interesting to share with you. This is their robotic system setup, and I think it's very similar. You can see and take a guess as to what type of robot they were using here, but this is very similar to how we set up our robotic platform as well. Oftentimes, I actually just remove the C-arm once I've taken a confirmatory shot, and I usually use the C-arm to take the first shot of the first cannulated pedicle to ensure that I think the robot knows roughly what it's doing, and I often do this before I cannulate the pedicle when the drill guide is down in an AP and lateral, and so we get an idea that the robotic system has an idea of where it is. Take the C-arm out, place all of your screws, and then take an AP and lateral to confirm. Some people spin with an intraoperative 3D imaging system, and that's reasonable as well. So this was a single center prospective randomized trial, single or two level lumbar disorders, and they were randomized into the and blinded into the MIS robotic category or the open with fluoroscopy. The only real difference here in preoperative characteristics was the ODI. They had 60 patients, and here are their results. They had about a 62.5% reduction in radiation. You can see that here. You can see that they did it both in terms of fluoroscopic time per screw and then also in the radiation per screw. They had they thought that they increased the amount of space between the facet increasing or at least decreasing the likelihood of maybe causing facet arthropathy at the highest level of your construct, preventing or reducing the likelihood of adjacent level disease. And they also had a significant reduction of length of stay. And I think this goes back to understanding minimally invasive surgery is more so a thought process and a strategy outside of really incision size and exposure. So this is their learning curve, and I think it's nothing that we wouldn't have assumed already, but the more of these cases you do, the faster, the more efficient you're able to be when you're placing instrumentation. So when we think about minimally invasive surgery, which we were talking about earlier, there are a lot of detractors. Fluoro intensive. We talked about how fluoroscopy and the use of intraoperative x-ray can cause cancer and has caused cancer in a number of our colleagues. We talked about how it can be limited exposure. Are you doing an incomplete surgery? And then fiddle factor. Are you fluent with the use of AP x-rays and gadgets? And the question is, are you confident in the imaging? If you give the robot, if you give your navigation system poor images to begin with, it's going to give you poor data output, which means you may not be navigating properly. You may not actually be where you think you are. So how do you increase confidence? Well, start out by picking the right patients. Pick the patients where MIS surgery is going to be easier, robotic surgery is going to be easier to help you start learning how to use some of these techniques. Preoperative planning, you can use 3D and virtual reality. I showed you some of a glimpse of some of that I use. I think it helps me understand how long I need to make the construct, where I think the potential pitfalls are, and whether I think I can do interbodies at certain levels. Dynamic films, bone and soft tissue studying. Intraoperative imaging is very helpful. You pick your flavor of intraoperative imaging, but just have a strategy as to how you're going to get out of trouble if you feel like the robot's not accurate or you feel like you have a misplaced screw. Intraoperative navigation and image guidance, we talked about that. Neuromonitoring, I think a lot of us use that here as well. And then post-procedural imaging, make sure you're teaching yourself and giving yourself feedback and take case notes and understand where you might have thought things were a little difficult and then what the outcome truly was in a CT scan. And then intraoperative visualization, make sure you can see what you need to see. Maybe start out using robotic systems in an open platform instead of a closed platform. This is not new. You know, we looked at O-arm navigation versus a C-arm, and we talked about this and covered this earlier, so I'll skip through it quickly. But for the most part, the O-arm group had significantly less screw malplacement rate at a rate of 0.93%, over 99% accurate. This number varies, but I think it's reasonable to say that with an intraoperative imaging system, you can be more accurate. Dr. Drazen actually presented this paper earlier from the Canadian group looking at cost effectiveness. The basic conclusion was that an incremental cost effectiveness ratio of $15,000 can justify the capital cost for something like this. And if you're doing more than 250 instrumented spine surgeries per year, this system could actually be of great benefit to you financially, and in the sense that it would pay for itself. conclusions. So I do think that robotics will help increase the adoption of minimally invasive surgery. It allows you to do things, and a lot of people who may not be comfortable with AP and lateral floral repetitively for pedicle screw placement to do some of that work. Target neurosurgeons familiar with cranial navigation. Any of us who have done sort of the brainstem cases that require extraordinarily accurate neuronavigation know where the pitfalls are, and we have to build that training into spine surgery to help prevent and transfer some of that knowledge into this space as well. Orthopedic surgeons are using it for joint navigation, so I think that they have sort of a predisposition to potentially enjoying the benefits of it as well. And I think imaging modality is key. The robot is only as accurate as the data it receives. And my advice to you is be safe. Learn the pitfalls, study them in the lab, and always maintain a high level of suspicion for failure. Initially, with the robotic system, I took the same number of x-rays as I would if I were placing the screws freehand, and I built confidence in understanding how it works. And I think that workflow allowed my team and our practice at Stanford to have that confidence to use the system safely. So I hope that was helpful to you in sort of getting an idea of where robotics is and where we're headed, and happy to answer any questions. Thanks so much.